Everybody's raving about the hybrid kickoff. Sure, sure, we'll get into that. But also, hybrid show, what about it? So many sports covered on the Up and Adam show. Zach Moss on running the backfield in Cincy. John Rothstein is here to talk about some March Madness. And Jordan Spieth on the road to the Masters. Yeah, Jordan Spieth's here. That's right, we're hitting the tournament. We're going to talk a little college ball. We're going to talk a little golf. Masters is here? A question mark? Ish? Something? We're going to ask him about, I mean, Happy Gilmore 2. I watched that movie. I was born for this moment. Gronk got me set for it. If you guys have questions for Jordan Spieth, definitely hit up the YouTube chat, of course. I'm looking at the live chat here. Good morning. Good morning. Starbucks black coffee. No sugar, no cream. Jordan, you're correct. Is this my home studio? No, it's not. I'm here at work. We got lots of questions streaming in for Jordan Spieth about talking to his ball. Does it actually work? Why has he changed the way he swings his driver? I don't know. We'll talk to him about all of that. If you have questions, light it up. Zach Moss, Bengals running back. He now gets a backfield of his own, finally. Can't wait to talk to him about all of that. And John Rothstein will make some picks. But we're gonna start with the breaking news of the morning in the NFL world. Yup! The NFL has approved a new hybrid kickoff rule. It's supposed to lead to more kickoff returns while drastically reducing the potential for injury. This is very XFL-ish. And you can see what it's going to look like right here, courtesy of, listen, we can show XFL highlights all day. I love this. This is a pretty drastic change, as you see, and it has worked well at the XFL level. Note, at the XFL level. The question I have, this is cool. How does this look and how does this work with NFL level athletes? Are we going to see a touchdown on every kickoff? Like, are we going to see too many big returns? Are these kickers in the NFL so skilled at the professional level that they'll start pinning people deep? Hamilton, I've got questions. You've got answers.
I don't know if I have all the answers. I mean, I'm excited that the kickoff, it's the most exciting play in football. It's awesome that we're going to get a chance to see it come back. Those questions you bring up are very valid, and I think that's why the NFL is doing this on a one-year trial basis. But the exciting part is, yeah, the kickoff had an exponential increase in injuries compared to a regular scrimmage play. They found that this version of the kickoff doesn't increase the risk of injury at all. Right. So we can kind of get the best of both worlds here. And it's an exciting day for the NFL. But, yeah, there's still a lot to be seen here because you're right. When you get those athletes in, what is this really going to look
and
like at this level?
I'm not saying anything against the XFL athletes, but it is a what's the difference in talent level, physicality level, and if you have better returners, but you have better guys trying to stop them, what does it look like? Does it even itself out?
Yeah.
Or does Xavier Worthy's draft stock get affected here? I'm not kidding. Does he get a little? He wakes up this morning and he's like, oh, hell yeah.
Yeah, no, it is an opportunity, not only for return specialists who have been kind of phased out of the game, but also coverage guys like a Cornelius Johnson who excelled that we had on the show, who excelled at special teams in Michigan. This makes him more valuable now, too.
Is Michael Pittman ready? Is he listening? Has he heard the new rule? I mean, honestly, Hamilton, you can stay with me here. We've got Colts receiver Michael Pittman joining us on this. Michael, you just heard Hamilton sort of break it down. I told you the new kickoff rule got passed this morning, basically the NFL adopting a modified version of the XFL's kickoff. What do you think of this? Because obviously more kickoff returns with lower injury risk. You returned plenty of kicks in college. Your dad, by the way, had some pretty nice kickoff returns for the Bucks. How do you feel about this?
Yeah, I mean, if it does what it's supposed to do and it helps guys not get hurt, then I think that it's a good thing. I haven't really done much special teams, so I don't really know how it's going to affect everybody like at the pro level and if it's going to create jobs or if it's going to diminish jobs. Like, I mean, like, I guess we're all just going to find out.
But I feel like what if there's a touchdown scored and the beginning of every game, that's not going to change your job a little bit?
Well, I mean, it definitely would because it puts pressure on you if, like, the other team scores first play. And then if we score, then we don't get on the field now. And then, like, and then now I have to sit on the bench for another 4 minutes. So it can be good and bad, but you know, it's a team sport. And football is constantly adapting, so this is just one of those adaptations that we're going to have to get used to.
Michael, it doesn't feel like you're excited about it. Are you excited about the new hybrid kickoff rule?
Am I excited about it? I mean, I think it's interesting.
You're like me, because I'm like, okay, I guess we'll talk about this. But everyone's like, breaking news, da da da, and I'm like, oh, okay, I guess.
Yeah, I mean, I think a better guy on my team to ask would be Zaire Franklin or EJ Speed, because those guys came up doing that, and they probably have a way stronger.
Yeah, I only bring you on not to talk about.
I haven't had a lot of opportunity.
Yeah, I don't bring you on to talk about kickoff, of course. I bring you on to talk about farming. That's what we're going to do. Because last time I talked to you, you told me that you and your beautiful wife purchased 42 acres of land. There were some cows on your Instagram story. I was like, what am I looking at here? The other day you posted this video with you moving and stacking 5,200 pounds of hay. Michael, did you not just get $67 million? Are you doing being rich wrong? What is happening here?
Well, I mean, like, I don't think there's a right way of doing so-called... I mean, I actually don't even like those terms, but we've been financially blessed with everything that's happened lately. But this is just what we like to do. My wife has had horses since she was a kid, and I've always liked the outdoors and doing things outdoors. And actually the first, because everybody asks me, like, what's the first thing that I bought? The first thing that I bought is landscaping, because my lawn looks terrible. So I got to fix it. I have a lot of grass and it looks terrible. So that's the first thing I bought was grass seed.
It's the most old man dad answer I've ever heard. I'm fixing my lawn. I'm working on the landscaping, but I'm happy. I mean, if it makes you happy, I'm happy for it. That looks like no fun to me, but I'm glad you're enjoying it. And hey, congratulations on the deal.
Thank you.
And it's been a whirlwind of an offseason for you. You get hit with the tag. You get the 3-year extension with the Colts right at the start of free agency, so it's over and you can work on your hay because you made your hay. Did you know this was going to get done throughout the process, or was there a weird, was there any moment of drama or uncertainty?
No, it was pretty streamlined. And when I got hit with the tag, like, they told me that was going to happen, and that was just part of the process, because we needed more time to talk. But there was no doubt that I was going to be a Colt, that everything was kind of going the way that I thought it would go. And we're here, and I'm still a Colt, and I'm excited about it, and I can't wait. I've actually been texting Anthony, like, at least, like, 4 or 5 times a week. Like, I'll just send him, like, random texts, like, just, like, to let him know that, like, I'm thinking about him, or, like, just, like, check on him, or just send him random just funny text, like, just to get him thinking.
How is he? I had Darius Butler on last week, and I told him, obviously he's plugged into that community, I'm like, nobody's talking about Anthony Richardson, and I think he's going to be like the post-hype explosive candidate that takes 2024 by force. I really do.
Absolutely. Anthony is doing great. I just seen reports saying that he's ready for our spring training is college football. He's ready for OTAs. Sorry. And I can say that because that's public, because, like, just that's public, and then it's put out there, because I don't want to give up too much information.
Gotcha.
But so they said that he's ready, and I'm just excited for him. And he's had basically a whole year to watch everyone else play. You know, like, he's seen Bryce, he's seen CJ, he saw Will, so just, like, being able to see those guys, like, I know that he's hungry to show what he can do.
Everybody I've talked to in that building, players, personnel alike, front office even, that he's a leader, that he really wants to be the best. Is this the kind of guy, once he's perfectly healthy and ready to go, is he calling you saying, like, when can I come to the farm? Let's get some routes in. Is he the kind of guy who's going to organize, you know, a trip for this receiving core? Like, what is he made of in as he looks forward to a healthy year?
Absolutely. I got him to the farm once last year, and I've been trying to get him back. I kind of scared a couple of my teammates, like, with my cows. I actually got him in the pen, and then the cows kind of like they didn't chase him.
Oh,
but
my God.
They were galloping towards them, and they all got scared.
Which players got scared?
It was the receivers and the quarterbacks, and they all started scattering like they were being attacked by, like, monsters or something. We definitely have something planned that we're going to do. We don't know the location yet. Of course, I want to get him out to California, but at the end of the day, it's like it's like going to be like a group thing. So, but California is my vote. So.
Okay, that's where you guys want to work out and work out together. Yeah. I do want to ask you, if you're very honest with me, because I'm very curious, because you are one of these receivers, rare air, that you do okay with whoever's throwing you the ball. You really do. If you look at the numbers, you've caught passes from 9 different quarterbacks. That's freaking so crazy. 9 different quarterbacks over the course of your 4 seasons, and you're still top 10 in the league in catches in that span. How much of a factor was Anthony Richardson in you wanting to return to Indy? Because they tagged you, but you could have fought that tag. You could have demanded a trade. You could have played out the tag, but you came to terms and wanted to be there.
Absolutely. Like, I want to start this off by saying that I've been fortunate that the Colts didn't just bring in anybody. Like, we brought in a quality group of quarterbacks that helped me succeed to what I've done so far. So, like, I just want to credit, like, all of those guys. But I definitely was interested in coming back and playing with the same quarterback for 2 consecutive years, right? Because so far that seemed like a dream, but now it's actually happening. And I'm so excited, and I'm so excited for him and everything that we're going to do this year. Like, it's going to be great. And it's just great to develop that continuity. Like, he knows who I am. Like, I know, like, just like I, like, know his strengths. And we can kind of hit the ground running instead of having to start from ground zero.
So clearly Anthony played a big role, you having some consistency. It's like I'm looking at you like it's like a dream scenario for you to have some consistency at quarterback, even though you've played with some great ones. Very well-polished answer there. But you guys came so close to the playoffs. And I want to ask you about your coach, because he got a lot of love down the stretch of the season for what he did in year one. What is it that you sort of noticed in the stretch of year one as far as growth with this coach? Growth or chemistry? Yeah, I mean, like, what stepped, what sort of evolved about him?
Yeah, it's what he does a great job of is he plays to his players' strengths. So when Anthony went down week 3, we completely switched to a whole different offense, because obviously Anthony and Gardner are different types of quarterbacks. And he really put everybody in position to be successful, because preseason, I think everyone gave us like 4 games to win, which was crazy disrespect, but I just like, it is like what it is. But, and like, I just felt like, again, like he did a really good job of putting us in the right position to, basically make the most of the situation that we were dealt. So, and then coming down to that last game of the year, I think that it was a great play call. We just didn't execute it like as players. It wasn't any one person, but when you watch the film, the play was there, the first down was there, and we just couldn't get it done. But really, it shouldn't even have came down to that last play, but that's football.
I feel like outside, that's a really good answer, because nobody knows anything about your coach. Like, outside of he had a good year, outside of, like, of course, like, he's been a great offensive coordinator. What do I need to know about him? What can you tell me about him?
I would say the man loves ball. Like, he's super intense. And, like, that's the thing is, like, people probably don't know much about him because he's only football, like, all the time. So it's like, he doesn't like to – like, not that he doesn't like to do anything else. He's just so focused, like, all the time. Like, we went to the NBA All-Star weekend. And,
oh, yeah.
And, like, he's just talking ball the whole time. And I'm like, Coach, let's just watch. Like, let's just watch this NBA All-Star
game. What do you
mean?
Like, what kind of ball? Like, is he literally, like, showing you new concepts and browser?
Oh, no.
What is he talking about?
He'll like talk about concepts. He'll talk about Anthony. He'll talk about, hey, like I'm thinking about this year and what we're going to do and all this stuff I have like in my head. And like, he's always going like this. Like, he's always like using his hands, always like that.
Okay.
So, he's just a super, super like awesome guy. And I'm very glad that he's our coach. So I think he does a great job.
You're like, dude, we're here. The 3-point contest is going on. Like, what? Like, I'm trying to have a good time, Coach. Like, loosen up.
Yeah.
You know, we have Zach Moss coming on the show right after you.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Are you going to miss him? Oh, let's bring on Zach before we say bye to you. Like, Zach, you're, oh, this is gonna, this is bad.
Hey, buddy.
So, what's up?
So, actually, Zach, now that you're not a Colt, I'm just going to take everything like from, like, your locker, like, all your drinks, like, all your I'm taking it all.
Okay, before I let you guys go, I want, because Minshew.
Yeah, he's already doing that. He's already on your way.
Yeah, Zach, congrats on your, I mean, this, you two are just, they're two little happy little clams here in the offseason. Like, the deals are done. You're ready to start for the rest of your careers, and you guys are figuring things out. I do want to ask you guys about Gardner Minshew. We're going to do that in the break, though. We're going to take a break, but we're live on YouTube. It's a whole thing you guys don't have to worry about. We will be back. We've got Jordan Spieth on the show. We've got John Rothstein to talk a little hoops. Here in a minute, but Zach, good to see you. Congrats, Bengal, my favorite. I do want to ask you guys about Minshew because he's, you know, Zach, I'll start with you. You said Minshew's a starting quarterback in this league. How's he going to do with the Raiders?
Yeah, he's going to just continue the success that he, you know, was building on in Indy. You know, he came in and stepped in and did a good job of just kind of leading troops, you know, each and every week. You know, obviously after we lost Anthony and things like that, no one was kind of, you know, lost any, you know, courage or anything like that. Kind of like, oh, man, we don't have Anthony anymore, you know, things like that. You know, Gardner stepped in and did a great job of just controlling everything and putting us in the best situation to win some games.
Michael,
definitely looking forward to it.
What are you going to miss about Minshew most?
I'm going to start with this. Everybody loves Gardner. There's just something about his attitude, the way that he carries himself. Like he's just a great dude to have around. And I think that everybody is going to, like, miss that. But he is always the most fired up guy. He works incredibly hard. And like I said, like, he's just, like, a good teammate. I think that is what I'm going to miss most, is just having him as a teammate.
And now you've got Joe Burrow to deal with, Zach Moss. Do you guys play each other this year? I haven't looked.
I hope so, because I'm going to run out of defense and tackle Zach.
Zach knew he wasn't playing you. All right, Mike, you know, Zach right away, he got that deal with Cincy and was like, Colts.
You definitely got to look right away. I was definitely looking right away.
I bet. Michael, we appreciate you. Congrats on the deal and on your hay and on the other hay and on everything. And we'll talk soon. What a year for you.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
I'm happy for you, Zach. We're going to be back on the air in 1 minute. How are you feeling? You good?
Sounds good. I'm doing good. How you doing?
You know you're on my favorite effing team now. You know that, right?
I heard.
Let's go!
I'm excited, that's for sure.
Have you talked to Burrow?
Yeah. When I went out there to go sign, me, Gino, Gesicki, we all had dinner with Burrow, some of the coaches, Orlando Brown, and Teddy. So, yeah, we got to meet a few of the guys already.
Amazing. I've never met Burrow. He's like I was at a Kid Cudi concert, and he was standing right there, and it was like, go talk to him. We'll take you to him. Like, go. And I was like, I was too scared to meet him like he was Santa Claus or something. All right, we're back. This is on YouTube, of course. We're back on the air in just a second, so we'll be with you. Oh, wow. I'm so happy for you. This is amazing. What a season for my next guest. With the Colts, career highs in carries, in rushing yards, in touchdowns, that leading him to go over to my favorite city, Cincinnati, and sign a 2-year deal with the Bengals. Zach Moss, congratulations. How does it feel?
Thank you. It feels good. It feels real good. I'm excited. To kind of continue to build off the momentum I had last season and do it in Cincy now.
You said you got to hang out with Joe Burrow a little bit. You guys had a dinner. Was Skyline Chili on the menu, or was it just with Mike Gesicki that you were doing that? Because they had you try the chili soon after you signed. What did you think?
Yeah, that was at the facility making our rounds of all the media stuff. But it was smooth. I think definitely if it's hot, you know, I'll definitely have to check it out when it's hot. I think it might be a little bit better.
It was, you ate cold Skyline chili?
The chili was warm. The hot dog was cold.
What a gamer you are. What a gamer you are for doing that. You know who you make proud? Every Bengals fan, everybody who supported you throughout your career. Gardner Minshew, of course. You know who else you make proud? Yeah, let's get rid of the hot. Your mom. Let's talk about your mom, who, you know, you did the thing that is everybody's dream to do. You took care of her. You got her house in Florida after you signed your rookie deal with the Bills, of course. And then you go on to work your way into what is your backfield in Cincinnati and what an opportunity. What were her thoughts? What was that moment like when you got this deal?
Yeah, you know, everybody was happy. It was a special moment. You know, it was really hard. To even get to a second contract in this league, especially at the running back position. So everybody was happy, excited. Definitely looking forward to, you know, doing a lot of good things in Cincy. And, I mean, just so excited just to get to work with those guys coming up here in a few weeks and OTAs and things like that. So I'm definitely looking forward to it.
What is it like to know that you're walking into that RB room and it's yours? And you're walking out onto that field and that backfield is yours?
Yeah, I mean, you know, definitely take a lot of pride in it. We got a lot of great guys in the room. Chase Brown, Trevion Williams. And obviously, I'm sure the show will bring some guys in and things like that. But, you know, definitely looking forward to just trying to, you know, be a leader in the room, be a guy that they can depend on, the whole offense can depend on each and every week, and just be a pro and do my job at a high level and do that consistently.
I mean, I'm looking at your numbers. You had just a lick under 1,000 yards. 7 touchdowns while you were splitting time with Jonathan Taylor, who I know that you know and love and have a lot of respect for. The best is still to come here, I think.
Yeah, you know, I think last year did a ton for my confidence, you know, in the way that the coach depended on me and leaned on me when JT was out. Obviously, JT's a hell of a player. So, you know, obviously when he came back, it made things a little rough, having to split time and kind of figure out how are we going to do the carries and things like that. And just not a lot of plays when you have two backs that kind of want the ball all the time. But, you know, it was a great, great time in Indy. I appreciate my time there. Love everybody there. It was just so good for me to kind of just get back to knowing what I can do. And now I got a chance to go do that in Cincinnati. And like I said, I'm looking forward to it.
You're such a powerful running back. And I spent a lot of time last year. I was very intrigued by Chase Brown because they clearly trotted him out there a little more. Second half of this, you know, I got to see a little bit more about him. So you've got this power thing going. He's got this nice speed thing going. I like this combo. I don't think enough people are talking about it, and they probably won't until they see it. How well do you think you two complement each other?
Yeah, he had a big day against us when we played Cincy last year. And the first thing that popped out to me was speed. Explosiveness and what he can do with the ball in his hands and get him in space. So I think he's going on his second year, if I'm not mistaken. So it's obviously a lot of growth that he can have there and things like that. And my job is to come in and try to be, you know, someone he can lean on and take experiences from and share those experiences with him and try to make sure he is the best player he could be.
What do you take from, like, your relationship? It's always been sort of a not totally your backfield. Obviously, you have a compliment in Chase here. Young player, like you said, entering his second year. What do you take from your relationship, even with Jonathan Taylor, who I know you have a lot of reverence for? And what do you take from that and how you approach this running back room and these sort of younger guys?
Yeah, I think, you know, just kind of take, you know, what JT showed. And he was, you know, a leader amongst leaders. Just the way he came into the building every single day, the way he prepared, the way he treated everybody. In the room, outside of the room, staff. So I think just taking those aspects away from it and adding that more of that to me and just going out there and doing the work as well, showing the guys what the work looks like. And like I said, they all hard workers, so they know what work looks like. And I'm obviously going to learn things from those guys as well, getting to know them and stuff like that. So I've been around some good ball players and taking a lot of good things away from them. So hopefully I can just add that to our room.
So tell me everything about Joe Burrow. you got to spend some time with him. I've never met him. I'm too scared officially. I probably will never meet him and talk to him. What is he like?
Yeah, he's a really, like, you know, he has a presence about him, I think, that is very evident, even if you've never met him, like you said, like if you've never met him, kind of see him through the TV, like myself previously before, you know, but he has just a presence about him. He has a swagger about him, and you can tell he's all about his business. So I'm looking forward to playing with him and getting on the field and kind of just picking his brain and seeing what he likes, what type of, you know, type of player he is on game day, through the practice week and stuff like that. And, you know, but he definitely has a swagger about him that kind of gives off a lot of cool to him.
Is he very different from Gardner Minshew?
From the first encounter I had with him, yeah, he's totally different from Gardner. It's not many people who are even in the same realm as Gardner in his personality, but yeah, Gardner's a great dude too, though.
Yeah, a lot of Bengals fans watching. I'm very into that fan base. What do you want them to know about you? Because it's Joe Mixon, it's big shoes to fill. You know that. It's quite an opportunity for yourself, and you are playing with a team that has Super Bowl expectations.
Yeah. I mean, I've played with a team that had Super Bowl expectations. Obviously, now this time around, it'll be in a bigger role and things like that. But, you know, I kind of understand the expectations and kind of what it looks like from a day-to-day basis and stuff like that. But my job is, like I always say, my job is to come in and be consistent, put the work in, and, you know, kind of once I do that part of things, you know, I'll be real happy with the outcomes just because I know I put the work in and day out. Currently right now, in the middle of a workout right now. But then going to OTAs and, you know, the training camp prep and then go to training camp and get ready for the season. It's an everyday process. And I think I do a good job of putting the work in. And I think last year was a good example of being ready, staying ready, and taking full advantage of things when it came my way. So definitely looking forward to this season. I'm not a big talker in, you know, kind of expectations and what I'm putting on myself and stuff like that. But I'm definitely looking forward to the season. Obviously, we got a hell of a team, and, you know, everybody is looking forward to do a lot of good things. So no one's looking more forward to that than the guys on the team, for sure.
It's so funny because you say, look, you've played on a team with Super Bowl expectations. You start your career with the Bills. You are drafted there. You are on that squad. And then we had you on with Michael Pittman, your former teammate, Colts receiver. Mm-hmm. And I asked, did you guys play each other this year? Because I didn't know. And Michael's like, I don't know. And you go, no. Which means you went, you went and you looked and you said, of course you would. Like any player would. Am I playing my old squad? What is that going to be like as a Cincinnati Bengal facing the Colts? I'm curious, did you look if you're playing the Bills? Because you're not. But those things get very sticky between the Bengals and the Bills in the postseason usually. Have you thought about what it will feel like to play them? Have you given that any thought?
Yeah, I definitely looked if I was going to be playing the Bills. Obviously, even in free agency, I was kind of, when I was going through teams, you know, I knew Indy plays Buffalo this upcoming season at home, if I'm not mistaken. but even last year, preseason, when I was injured, they went to Buffalo to play, which would have been my first game back in Buffalo. So obviously, I haven't played them or even been back in the stadium. Since I left, we don't play them, obviously, this season. But, you know, they are definitely a playoff team. Great talent over there. And, you know, we are a playoff team as well in Cincy. So, you know, the odds look like we'll probably cross paths at some point.
You want to give them that work, is what I'm hearing. I'll say it.
I'm a competitor. I'm a competitor. I don't turn down. No opponent, you know, that's just how I was raised and things like that. So I'll be looking forward to playing whoever it is each and every week. This league is, you know, just full with great talent.
You had career highs. There was a lot of interest in you around the league. I'm so curious, why Cincy, why not Dallas?
Yeah, I mean, Cincy just made the most sense from the structure of the offense and how the offense is played and kind of the scheme of the offense and what they want to do. It's a lot of shotgun offense, a lot of inside zone, gap scheme runs and things of that nature. And I mean, it's hard to turn down, you know, a guy like Burrow, a guy like Chase and Higgins and just all the talent on both sides of the ball. And it's so much space, you know, that really intrigued me to get it, be able to play in a box where you only got, you know, six guys, maybe seven. And if it's seven, it's kind of going to be real hard for them to defend the pass game. So it just, something that I was, like, very, very intrigued about and super excited to be a Bengal.
And then they made you eat a cold hot dog, and you're like, why the F did I come here? Like, I clearly made a mistake.
It's okay. I've eaten cold food before.
Zach Moss, you're so humble, and I don't know why, because you're about to light it up for that team. I could not be more excited for you. Congratulations. And I do want to say, I know that you have a birthday coming up for your son, right? Let's shout that out. Xavier in June, that's coming up. Also, I mean, first Easter is this weekend. Look at this. I just wanted to show the beautiful baby.
Yeah, that's my little guy. He's growing fast. He's about to be one already in June. It's crazy.
I wonder if Burrow would
older
be a good,
he gets, the would older
Burrow
I get.
Be a, would Burrow be a good babysitter? I don't know.
That'd be a very interesting question.
Something you guys can talk about. I would say, are you a good chess player?
Chess, no.
Okay, I feel like that's his game. That's what everybody says. He sits there and he plays chess. So if you're trying to, like, work your way in, maybe chess. Not that you need to, of course. You've got it covered. You'll eat a cold hot dog. No one's better than you, Zach Moss. We appreciate you and congratulations. Hooday.
Absolutely. Appreciate you.
Good to see you, as always. Up next, we're going to talk a little NCAA hoops. John Rothstein gracing us with his presence in the busiest time of his life. And then we're just going to talk Roadhouse the entire time. Jordan Spieth on the show as well. His, like, frame, you know, wedding, the schedule. It's so funny.
I give him a lot of credit for how he handled it.
I'm like, oh my God.
And for not putting the bulletin board material out there, but he wants to give them that work so badly.
I know. I wish he would have doubled down on it, but he did it. But that's, Bengals fans will love that. Bengals fans would not like it if I said, got him to say something like that. But this is one of those, people out there have to understand, I'm asking him so that when they inevitably meet down the stretch, we can play this back. A la Aaron Jones taking the Cowboys to town for three tugs.
Yep.
You know, you say it on these airwaves and it happens, unless you're, you know, Stetson. Unless you're me picking Stetson to upset UConn and then, okay. Is John Rothstein wearing jorts, someone's asking? I don't know. How interesting is that question? What else did you make of Zach Moss? I think the thing about him having dinner with Gesicki and Burrow should be out.
Yeah, definitely.
That was from the break, though, so you should make sure. What else stuck out to you? I mean, him picking running scheme in Cincy over, I don't know if it was over whatever was going on in Dallas.
Yeah, that was interesting too. How much the scheme factored into it. The Chase Brown stuff was interesting. You know, the Bengals fans love Chase Brown and are intrigued by him. They are going to make a hell of a pairing. And it's one that I think a lot of people are going to be sleeping on because I don't think Chase Brown is as well known nationally. And obviously, Zach, you know, flew under the radar a little bit last year too. So,
Jordan.
Be good to get ahead on. But it is funny. It's just I'm thinking more about the schedule. Remember when like Nate Burleson was like,
he
didn't look at the schedule at all. He had no idea they're playing. Yeah. Like,
but I do.
And you look at Zach. Like,
I mean, Pittman's like that. Pittman's like, I don't know. I don't care. But like, imagine. I mean, that's just a human. It's just I don't know why we find it interesting.
Yeah.
Because it's just like a normal thing that happens.
Yeah. But I think the Bills is especially personal, given what kind of happened there with him.
Yeah. Hey, why do we? Does he usually wear jorts? What's happening? Okay.
Oh God.
Are we not starting with Roadhouse? I'd like to start with Roadhouse. Is that not a thing? Okay, we can do that. I'm excited. Let's do this. Yeah. Listen, everybody, this bracket season, FanDuel putting the ball in your court. Right now, new customers get $200 in bonus bets if your first $5 bet wins. That is $200 to use on point spreads and money lines. FanDuel, your place to get in on the tourney action. Download the app, bet on college hoops until they cut down those nets. All right, you can't say or even think or even conjure or even contemplate college hoops without this guy appearing out of thin air, host of the College Hoops Today podcast, silent reporter extraordinaire for CBS, college basketball self-dubbed hungriest insider, John Rothstein. This is your life.
It is my life, Kay. Happy March.
Happy March to you. We're talking about we're going to talk about, of course, hoops. But I want to ask you, you're my movie guy. You're my critical film review guy here. I'm sure you have not had time to see the remake of Roadhouse, have you?
I haven't seen the original.
You're with me on this. Wait, that would be something I figured you had seen. I was completely wrong here.
No, it just never made my rotation of movies that I've watched, you know, from 1984 to 2000. I keep a tight window in that 16-year span, but it never made the rotation.
Have you seen Happy Gilmore?
I saw Happy Gilmore, one of Carl Weathers' most underrated films. May he rest in peace. We just lost him. Not exactly Apollo Creed material, but still a pretty, pretty good role for Carl Weathers.
Yes, unbelievable. And then we have the second one coming up. Are you excited about that? Do you like remakes in general?
Remakes in general, it depends what the remake is. Creed, Jurassic World, I can live with. But beyond that, remake in general. Yeah, Jurassic World. I mean, nothing will touch the original Jurassic Park in 1993. I mean, that's a classic. That's something, you know, you remember when you saw it the first time. But remakes in general, I could probably live without.
John, how are you holding up this March? How's it going? We see you everywhere. You're on everything. You know, I saw you advertising for a wrestling belt with your face on it. What's going on?
Right. You know, March is a month where the best way I can describe it is I kind of feel like a CPA on April 14th. There's not enough hours in the day. You're trying to cram everything in. But the most intense couple of weeks is the start of conference tournaments to the end last week of the first week. I was on the road last week. I'm back in the studio this week on CBS Sports Network. So, you know, you take your dry cleaning in, you get your laundry done, you get a haircut, you start to feel like you're yourself again.
And then on the 14th, you have somebody like me showing up at the door like, by the way, I need to do my taxes well. And it's all bedlam and all madness. How mad is the madness right now?
You know, it's not incredibly mad as we've seen in the past in terms of the potential upsets. You know, we have a chalky Sweet 16. To me, it's one of the best Sweet 16s we've seen in terms of matchup in quite some time. It's the first time since 2019 that all four number one seeds have made the Sweet 16, but that makes for some scintillating basketball. But Kay, the part of what makes March Madness so special is because of how college basketball continues to reiterate that is where the unexpected becomes the ordinary. In the Ivy League championship game, Brown was beating Yale for probably 39 and a half minutes, but one final play and one final run and one execution by Yale gave Yale the opportunity to earn an automatic qualifier out of the Ivy League to go to the NCAA tournament. And then the Bulldogs, who are a program, obviously, that has been very underrated in the Northeast under James Jones, was good enough to beat Auburn in the round of 64. And when you think about other upsets that were forecasted on Selection Sunday by people speaking with conviction, nobody talked about Oakland beating Kentucky. And the star of Oakland beating Kentucky was Jack Golke, who 5 years ago redshirted at a Division II school before eventually opting to transfer to Division I. Okay, it's not anarchy. It's just college basketball.
It's just college basketball. What do you make? I mean, the Kentucky thing was crazy. What does it mean for John Calipari?
Well, John Calipari's buyout right now is $33,375,000. So that's a lot of calamari. And I will say this without hesitation. If John Calipari could get fired and get a check for over $33 million not to coach, it is one of the great accomplishments that we have seen in the history of mankind.
Okay, so we've got a great slate. You're saying it's a chalky but great slate of Sweet 16 games, and that starts on Thursday to look forward to. Is there an upset pick you'd like to make with conviction on this program?
You know, the four teams that I picked to go to the Final Four, UConn, Arizona, Houston, and Purdue, are still alive. I think they're the team to monitor in the Sweet 16 that could really come out of its region and isn't a one or two seed is Creighton. Creighton had a dramatic win against Oregon in the round of 32. Creighton, as you remember, last year was a play away from going to the Final Four. And this has been the line of demarcation for Creighton's opponent, Tennessee, in the NCAA tournament under Rick Barnes. Tennessee has averaged 24 wins in the last six seasons under Rick Barnes. But for all intents and purposes, the Vols have not been able to get past the Sweet 16. So I nickname all the regions, as you know, each and every year.
Right.
And the Midwest region this year is the region of tension, because you've got Tennessee, who has never gotten past the Sweet 16 under Rick Barnes, and you have Purdue, the story that has brought people in from the periphery, the stories that has fathers and sons and friends and people of alumni of all sorts going through the fact that this could be the year. This could be the year that Purdue exercises its demons. And people might say, well, what are you talking about, exercise its demons? Well, let's go through the last half decade with Purdue in the NCAA tournament.
Okay.
In 2018, you have a team that's good enough to go to a Final Four. And in the NCAA tournament, Isaac Haas, nicknamed the Big Avocado, hurts his elbow and can't play in the Sweet 16 against Texas Tech. Purdue loses to Texas Tech. 2019, Purdue is taken to the gates of hell when it loses to Virginia in the Elite Eight. Purdue was up 2 points late in regulation. Kihei Clark threw the pass to Mamadi Diakite. As everybody remembers, Virginia wins in overtime.
Of course.
2020, no tournament. 2021, you're a four seed. You're Purdue. You lose to North Texas. 2022, you have a team that has Travion Williams, Jaden Ivey, and Zach Edey, and you lose to St. Peter's, a 15 seed in the Sweet 16. And then last year, the biggest upset in the history of the NCAA tournament. An upset that was so big, it caused an entirely different level of scuttle on social media. An upset that was so big that it changed the way that people look at 16 seeds for the history of mankind. Now, why do I say that? Fairleigh Dickinson last year was a program that was not good enough to win the Northeast Conference tournament. Mm-hmm. Merrimack won the Northeast Conference tournament, but Merrimack was ineligible to go to the NCAA tournament because of the transition rule. So Fairleigh Dickinson not only goes to the NCAA tournament, it has to play a first four game in Dayton. And then Fairleigh Dickinson, David, if he was ever epitomized to be a college basketball player, slays Goliath and Zach Edey. And now Purdue is two wins away from bookending the run of all these players, Braden Smith, Fletcher Lawyer, Zach Edey, with something that could only be seen in Hollywood. But you and I both know that life is not a movie. And for life, for one time, to truly reflect drama, it will have to be Purdue winning two more games, because the Boilers are 80 minutes away from immortality, but they're also one loss away from coming up just short. And you know this, when you're this close, you're also that far away.
Understood. All I remember, I didn't know the whole history of Purdue, and now I do. I like waking up in the morning and knowing I'm going to learn something, and I just got the whole history of them. What I remember is that you were so hot on them last year, and you picked them to win the entire thing, and then they lost in that first round, which you just reminded me of, and now I just reminded you how hot you were on them. Do you have faith they can do it and win these games and make that beautiful bookend ending?
This is a different Purdue team than last season. You have the National Player of the Year in Zach Edey, Braden Smith, Fletcher Lawyer, all better than a year ago. Lance Jones, the transfer from Southern Illinois, the grad transfer, is a big-time addition. But you've got a Gonzaga team up next. You've got the winner of Tennessee Creighton after that, if you're fortunate enough to beat Gonzaga. Nothing is easy in life, and nothing will be easy for Purdue to get to the Final Four for the first time since 1980. Will they do that? Sometimes in life, just when you think you find out the answer, somebody else changes the question. Because this is March.
You're an unbelievable specimen. Ron Rossney, we appreciate you. We will talk to you soon. Try to get some sleep. I don't even know what to... I mean, I know we'll sleep in May. We'll sleep in May. We appreciate you. Up next, we got our friend Jordan Spieth. He is back. Chandler Parsons said, just ask him how cool I am. Ask Jordan Spieth how cool Chandler Parsons is. We'll talk to you. Our guy Jordan, next. I have no words, Hamilton.
I mean, we learned the entire history of Purdue in the tournament.
I just don't know what to do with John Rothstein. You just wind him up and then we're in Encyclopedia Britannica. And then I'm like on my, you know, like we're changing the CD-ROMs in and out, fast and furious. Like I'm learning them. And then all of a sudden he goes into like, you know, we're Jillian Turecki relationship life coach on Instagram. Like he turns into like, brings that all back to like a life lesson. And at the end of a Mr. Rogers episode, all in one answer to one question.
You put it perfect. He's a specimen. That was,
did he
really
pick
something.
An upset when I asked him to pick an upset?
No, I he honestly just said, can't.
He didn't, did he? Did he pick an upset from the Sweet 16? He did not. He said, the four teams I picked to pick go to the thing are Purdue and UConn, and I didn't get any answer. He's so funny.
And I honestly, I'm stunned. You know, I don't like being this person. Oh, you haven't seen that movie, but with his movie Rolodex that he'd never seen Roadhouse was pretty shocking.
I respect it. I love it. I hate people who shame people for not knowing movies. I wasn't about to do that.
I'm not shaming him. I'm just, with his history, I'm surprised.
Yeah,
that's
but you
all. Because it seems like he's seen every movie.
People get judged hard on whether or not they've seen any movie. I'm sorry. Like, it doesn't say anything about you. It literally says nothing about you whether or not, unless there's like, I mean, I guess we can go into like super specific hyper genres of things that are like polarizing and like borderline, like controversial, fine. But we're not going in those aisles in the, you know, back of Blockbuster. We're talking about like any Rolodex of movies. Like, it doesn't say anything about you.
Yeah.
So I don't like, I hate movie shaming. It's one of my things.
I totally agree. Except for with you and your refusal to see Dune 2. That's a different story. But yeah.
I don't want to see Dune 2, Dune 1, Dune anything. There's that weird popcorn thing you brought to my attention that I'm not interested in, not even slightly. Like, I watched Happy Gilmore for Gronk. Now, did Gronk do himself any favors when it was announced that Happy Gilmore 2 is coming out, which we'll talk to Jordan Spieth about, of course. Did he tweet, put me in this movie? No. I'm like, Gronk, I can lead a horse to water.
I can lead a
Gronk to Hollywood. You got a drink.
It was on a tee for him. No pun intended.
His team better be working that.
Yeah. We need to see it.
Oh, Jordan Spieth is here. Let's do this. Chandler Jones is literally like, ask him how cool I am. What? Time to welcome in our friend. 13 victories on the PGA Tour, 3 majors, very proud, Texas Longhorn. Last time I talked to him, I think he said he wanted to golf with Matthew McConaughey. And then you like threw Arch Manning in there, which was weird. You are a Dallas Cowboys fan. Jordan Spieth, how are you?
I'm doing great. How are y'all?
Always great to see it. Love the y'all. Got to get the y'all in there.
It's that part of the cycle where the Cowboys fan were like, we're at the bottom, and then here it comes. We start the new season, and then we're going to win the Super Bowl, and then we don't, and then we're a Texas Ranger fan right now.
Oh yeah, and I'm happy for you, and you should focus on the goodness, focus on the optimism there. I mean, is it like a different off season in that you're not having much optimism about the Cowboys? I can't imagine Cowboys fans are very like, let's go rah rah right now.
Well, I guess we'll just have to see how we draft, because we're in that lull in between free agency where not a whole lot was done and then the draft. So being a Cowboys fan is tough, but, you know, we stick together and maybe someday it'll be worth it.
They've had a quiet offseason, like you're saying. We'll see what they do in the draft. I mean, the draft, they've got, you know, 2 Longhorn receivers. Could be interesting. Would you like a Xavier Worthy, Mr. Speedy, or Mitchell? Like, would you like one of those guys?
Yeah, of course. But I mean, we need a running back right now. So it's probably priority number one offensively. But sure. Yeah, those guys are badasses. They are something else.
I think we shouldn't have started talking about the Cowboys. Cause that's just like not a good place to start. So, OK, before we get into to more Cowboys, I guess, maybe, or maybe some Longhorns, we'll talk about them, or your quest for a second green jacket at the Masters. Let's talk about Happy Gilmore, because I've got questions. Are you excited about it?
Yeah, very. That was like one of the best movies of my childhood, being a golfer. And then, of course, that's what I would go to school. And instead of being the dork that played golf, everybody would be asking questions about if you could do a Happy Gilmore. And, you know, it was like a little sprinkling of cool in the mixture of, you know, golf being kind of the fifth sport to play.
This morning I looked, and you have pulled a Happy Gilmore on the golf course. 2015, let's go.
Oh, wow. Okay. I don't remember this. I have no idea where this went.
You don't remember this?
That was a Jake Owens charity event, but seems like it might have buzzed some heads there. But
well, you didn't kill anybody.
I mean, I'll tell you what, that's pretty, to try that with those crowds right there, that was 21-year-old me. That's not very smart.
Now you're, you know, now you've got 2 kids. Last time I talked to you, you had 1 kid. What's going on? I mean, congratulations. Yeah. That's amazing. A baby girl, right?
That's right. Yeah. I feel like a kid, but now I'm in charge of two of them. But it's going great. They're awesome. It's fun.
No more Happy Gilmore for you. But with Happy Gilmore 2, and you're so excited about it, if Adam Sandler calls you about giving you, like, a prominent role, not a cameo, a prominent role, you have to learn lines, you have to give it, like, 2 months of your life or something, are you saying yes?
That's a really good question. I would hope that filming would be sometime between September and January, and I would be for sure in for that. But honestly, I think everybody that plays professional golf is looking for a shout out to potentially be in it. You have guys like Mickelson who have been in movies and shows, and some other players over the years, and now you finally have one of these movies being remade. It would be pretty awesome to have any part, no matter how small.
Have you met Adam Sandler?
I've not met Adam Sandler. That would be pretty awesome. I've grown up a fan of all of his movies.
Did he like get you to? Did this get you to like love golf even more? How big of a role in your career did Happy Gilmore play?
Like I said, it was just honestly, it was something that made golf just incrementally cooler. Kind of at the same time, Tiger was actually making it pretty cool. So it certainly helped. But I wouldn't say that he was my inspiration on the golf course by any means. But I could probably quote most of the movie.
If you got to pick a cameo, who would you pick to get a cameo in this second film?
Well, you were just talking about Gronk on it. They got so many directions to go, but I think they got to go more entertainer route, like a Gronk versus golfers. But at some point, there's got to be a competition, so you got to have other players in it.
Gronk would be good. Who else?
Let's see. Steph Curry would probably make a lot of sense as a golfer that is obviously well known to everybody. I think that would help the movie out, and he would be great in it. He'd probably be a number one pick there if they spin it off a little into entertainers. He could play. He could do anything. He could be a pro in the movie. He could be whatever.
You just know Travis Kelce's people, his team, his agents are like, get me in this movie.
Yeah. I mean, why not? Yeah. I'm just thinking of guys who I know, like, you could have them actually hit a shot on camera and people could be like, okay, that could pass the test. I don't know if Travis can, but I know Steph can.
Yeah. Are you sad that because of this movie, and it'll probably film over a year, that you're going to be without your caddy, who's going to play the caddy since he looks like him? Will Zalatoris? You're going to lose
true.
Will Zalatoris on the tour because he's going to be the caddy in the movie.
That's right. I think he'd be in for it. I think he'd swallow his pride. He'd give in to you know, everyone who's always talked about him looking like that, and he'd for sure take the role. I mean, my caddy could definitely play Adam Sandler's caddy in the movie. He could go eat the cracker off the green as a ball marker, take the quarter. He'd be in for that too. But there's options.
Gronk made me watch this movie this year, and I'm so glad I did, because otherwise you and I would have nothing to talk about. Actually, I met a bunch of your friends. I talked to Smiley Kaufman and got all the dirt on all of you and your Baker's Bay stuff and your like just all the, and those boys are rowdy, those Justin Thomas and companies. Unbelievable.
Yeah, they are. I mean, When you give us a little time off, we're going to take advantage of it.
Who is the Shooter McGavin on tour right now?
Oh, man. There isn't much of one right now, is there?
Oh, we need one.
You know, Scheffler's out there, winning a lot of golf tournaments, Scottie Scheffler, but he's not a Shooter McGavin personality at all, so we need one.
We need one. Everybody needs an anti-hero. You know, obviously a big theme in Happy Gilmore is heckling. What is your best heckling story?
Oh, it has to be from Phoenix. I mean, I've heard plenty over the years. I've heard some good ones at other people, probably ones worse to other individuals than myself. The Ryder Cups on American soil, sometimes our fans go maybe a little overboard towards the Europeans. But it'd have to be either Phoenix or there. And I mean, people will go personal. But I mean, at the same time, like, how many games do I go to where I'm yelling at somebody? You know, I get a few beers in me and I'm at a Mavs game and I'm yelling at somebody.
You do?
You know, when, oh, absolutely. But
you're
I've
like,
done it
Jerry
since,
Jones,
you know,
get a running back.
Yeah, no, I try to stay away from the ownership. I don't really want to yell at the ownership, smart, but smart. You know, when like Luca and Devin Booker in each other's face, you know, I'm one of the guys in the crowd that's standing up yelling and, you know, I support my teams and, you know, if it's a, they can't really hear you much in a football game, but basketball or hockey or something.
So we're going to cast you as the guy in the movie that yells jackass the whole time. That's going to be Jordan Spieth and Happy Gilmore too. We have figured out a lot of things here during this short chat.
Yes.
Listen, I wanted to talk to you about playing this weekend, but you're not playing this weekend. And there's another tournament in your home state of Texas that you're not playing in ahead of the Masters. Why aren't you playing in them?
Well, I played the last 3 weeks, and then I plan on playing next week in Texas as well to get ready for the Masters. So I played three in a row. I got 1 week off, and I got another three in a row. So, at some point, you got to take a week off. And I've always loved playing in Texas, and this one just happened to fall kind of right after a few of our big events, and right before you know, the lead into Augusta.
I've learned a little golf from my Netflix Cup days with Justin Thomas and company. What is the one thing that you are working on, really working on, ahead of the Masters?
Right now, I'm kind of working on my wedges and my short irons, which is always fun to work on. But those are our scoring clubs. I've kind of, you know, put a lot of practice into more driving the ball and putting. And both I'm doing well right now. But some of my short iron and wedge game has been lacking, which is normally a strength of mine. So I just got to put more time into it this week and fire it up next week. So I got a checklist of items to do. You know, I get some mechanic stuff down, and then I go into kind of a lot of playing and really trying it out on the golf course. So just normal stuff. There's always something to work on in the game.
Confidence is good?
Yeah, confidence is good. I mean, I've had kind of a weird year. I missed a cut a couple weeks ago, and but I feel like my game's a lot better than it's been showing, and I'm heading into a few events that I've got a good history in.
Go get another green jacket. Bring it home.
You got it.
All right, appreciate you as always. Good to chop it up. Good luck. We'll be watching. And at some point, you'll have to explain to me that Riviera card thing, but just not, today's not the day for that. Yeah. Let's look ahead, yeah. And we'll tackle that next time. Thanks, Jordan.
That's right. See you, Kay. Thanks.